Okay, so let us take this network now. Okay, I would like you to start working on this network. We will solve it in this class. This is a network which we did our analysis on in the last class. So the analysis results are given there. Okay, I would suggest you could actually do a little bit of the analysis of the basic analysis to kind of refresh your memory, and then let's come back and calculate the various float parameters. So we'll get a few more insights into float when you analyze this network. Right now, with this, all the networks we took now was only introductory. Yeah, you have a question?
So you said that when we have a range of floats, as it for criticality of the chamber.
Yeah.
So
it's not so much a range of floats that your total float should be within. Say, I won't say total float should be zero for an activity to be critical. I'll say total float should be less than, only if any total float less than 5 is considered critical float.
So it means that there can be more than one critical path.
Yeah, yeah. There can be multiple critical paths. So that is something which we will get, we'll see a lot of in the next section, or when we do time cost trade-off. As my duration start reducing, or I have to start crashing, multiple critical path is really a fact of many projects. Only in some of these idealized simple examples which we do, we get single critical paths. No, you will get multiple. When we get to that, you'll see. But the question, what you're asking, is very relevant. A lot of times, there's never, almost in all practical case. Okay, there could be a single critical path, but typically people want the project done as fast as possible. In which case, I don't have time for float. I'm going to even try to, you know, get things done start scrunching the critical path itself, and as the critical path starts reducing, my float from the other activities go away, all paths start becoming critical.
So how do you decide upon the number of days
for criticality? No, so it depends on how much control you have on your project. You know, what is the level of uncertainty with which you can predict. Okay, so this having total float equals zero, so an activity is critical, is ideal. And if we go only by that definition, let's say there is another path with a float of one, you can easily lose one day on a activity. You might find that you are still tracking a critical path which is now not critical, because if there's 2 day delay on that path, what will happen? Critical path changes. And you are now pumping resources into what you thought was critical, but the critical path has changed. So you have to keep your eye on all of these activities which are near critical. And obviously, when you say criticality and near critical, the problem becomes much more interesting than and more complex than just saying there is a unique critical path and that's the only one I have to deal with. Okay, so just start off on this problem. There are quite a few interesting issues when you get into the details of this. So you can make the table. So you can actually we'll finally put this in a tabular form where we have we'll have A, B, C, D, we'll have the duration, we'll have the predecessor, we'll have early start, early finish, late start, late finish, total float. Okay, we can talk about criticality here, free float, interfering float, and independent float. Okay, so this will be the table, but once you have done the analysis, basic analysis, it gets you back into kind of thinking in terms of the forward pass, backward pass. Let us then talk about, discuss the floats. Okay, so here we know that A, D, G, H are on critical path. Need a little more time? Okay, so this is on critical path and we have no floats on that. Let's take B. Okay, let's take B. What let's take, so obviously B, C, E, F have floats. I think I will show the, put it under this, it would, so we here we have, so in a basic bar chart we can have the early start schedule, we can have the late start schedule. Okay, so and this is showing the full extent of float used in all the activities for the late start schedule. Okay, so if this analysis is done, let's actually try to discuss this, the different floats on the visual you can see here. So let's take B. We know that B can move all the way here, right? Its late finish is 17. So as I start moving B, so what is this whole distance which B can move? Total float. Okay, so that will be the total float of B. Okay, and how many days is that?
8 days.
Okay, is the total float of B. But when B starts moving beyond a certain degree, what happens? After it starts beyond moving beyond this, what happens? It starts affecting E. Okay, actually beyond here, because B is connected to E. After B goes beyond 12, it starts affecting E. So one way, before it affects E, what is the float of B? What is that kind of float called?
Free float.
Okay. So yeah, so B has 3 days of free float, so it can move 1, 2, 3. If it moves the fourth day, then E starts, the early start of E starts getting affected. Okay, so B has 8 days of total float, 3 days of free float. We can see that. If there are any questions, please raise it. What about E? We'll come back to the other two floats. Okay, we'll just take total float and free float first. What about E? Or what, we'll take C next. What about C? Total float of 5 days. So here is C. Okay, I can move it all the way. But if I, when I start moving C, what happens? Does it have any free float? No, it has no free float, because the minute I move C to the 13th day, E will start moving. Okay, and you can see that in the bar chart. So here is C, and E starts right here. Right, so there. At the minute I move C by 1, E will also start moving by 1. Okay, what, so of course D doesn't have. Now we go to E. What is the, how much of, so here is E. So when I'm moving E for total float and free float, I'm going here. I can move E all the way here. Okay, for 5 days. That is my total float. Free float is also the same. Okay, because it doesn't affect, it is converging to a critical activity, and I can move it all the way to 23 without affecting H. Okay, now F, total float of 7. Okay, so what about, so I can move again, F can move all the way to the end. It can end on 23 and then it will not hamper anything else. Okay, and free float is also 7. Okay, now so if we take the, so any questions on total float and free float? That's fine. Okay. Now we come to interfering float. So if we take B, you can see that as B starts moving, it interferes with E. Okay. How much can it interfere with E?
5.
So the first 3 days it doesn't interfere with E. The remaining 5 days it interferes with E. So out of 8 days of total float, okay, and 3 days of free float, 5 days are interfering float. Does it give you any clue to interfering float? Right. Okay, and you can see that visually. Okay. So that's what. Do you expect any other activity to have interfering float?
C has.
C has. Okay, so now if you think of total float minus free float is equal to interfering float, you will see that C has total float, it has no free float, so it will have, it's the same thing. So I can keep moving C, I'll be interfering all the way with E until the end, until it becomes critical. Okay. What about F?
No, zero.
Okay, F cannot interfere with H, because if it starts interfering with H, the project duration will change. Okay, and you will find that F, the total float and free float are
same.
So total float minus free float is zero. Okay, now we come to the independent float. So we take, okay, we take an, let's start with C. Although we'll start with B. A cannot be delayed. Okay, so A has no influence on B. If I delay B from the early start of B, or you know, if I delay B, will E get it delayed? No. Remember, it has free float,
yeah,
till 3 days. So do you remember the definition of independent float? Yeah. The successor, so we are going to constrain B as much as we can. How do we constrain B as much as we can? Then A should start at its late finish, and E should start at its early start. So if E wants to start at 12, A will still finish at 5, still B has room to move, correct? 3 days. That's independent flow. Let's go to C. Okay, E wants to start at 12, A wants to finish at 5. No, it has no independent float. We go to E. Okay, H wants to start at 23. Okay, there's room there, but C wants to end at 17. No, it cannot. Okay, what about F? H wants to start on 23. Okay, either C can be start on 17, or which is more constraining?
C.
So yes, C can start on 17. Yeah, so sorry, C can finish on 17, and still there is
3 days
of space. Okay, so now you have, so if I was going to think of an equation for independent float, what would it look like?
It is the minimum of maximum of
late start of late finish of the predecessor.
Okay, so as far as the late finish of the predecessor goes, it is the maximum value I have to take. Minus or yeah, minimum of the early start of the successor. So yes, minus activity duration. So there is a minimum early start of successor minus maximum late finish of the predecessor minus the activity duration. Okay, so if you so the challenge then becomes, you'll have to look through the predecessor successor, make sure you identify them properly, and then do this calculation. Okay, so this is the table which summarizes all what we have discussed. Okay, and we have also discussed the float terms mathematically. Okay, so if we put in the various terms, we have this is how we are looking at it. Total float is late start and early start. When we take a free float, minimum early start of successor minus early finish. Interfering float, we talked about total float minus free float, and we just discuss independent float. Okay, so in a large network, you understood the concept of each of these, but you would tend to use the formula a little more than going and checking if using the Bard graph or anything like that. Okay, but again, when you are using the formula, understand what is behind the formula. Okay, so we looked at the different types of floats, and we went through the definitions. We did a few calculations, went through examples, and I think all of you have actually understood it from the concept perspective. We looked at the equations also. We also discussed the use of float for project decisions, and this will come up. This will keep reoccurring. So I'm not spending a lot of time on the third point, because in every other aspect of critical path planning, float becomes a very important issue, especially the total float and the free float. Okay.